This is our last optimization problem, and in some ways, the most important because it can save somebody's life. That's true. Here you are. You're working as a lifeguard, and you see a struggling swimmer who's 120 feet out to sea in the water and 100 and 200 feet up the beach from you. So this is the diagram. Here's you. There's the swimmer. The beach, the water line, we're saying, is perfectly straight here. The swimmer is 120 feet out there and 200 feet in this direction from you. That means that the 200 should stop here. So if you can run in the sand at 13 feet per second and you can swim in the ocean at 5 feet per second, what path should you take to get to this swimmer? So what is the goal here? What are we really trying to optimize? We definitely want to minimize something. What is it that we want to minimize? What do you think? Take a minute. This is an important situation here to decide what our goal is. Is the goal to minimize the distance? We know that in normal Euclidean geometry, the shortest distance between two points is a straight line. So to minimize the distance, you would just go straight like that, meaning you would do what the whole way? You wouldn't run at all. You would just swim. And that might be the right answer. But why isn't that apparently, why isn't it obvious that that's the right answer? Because you can run so much faster than you can swim, meaning it might make more sense to first run some distance on the beach and then get into the water and swim towards the swimmer. Because the goal is not to minimize distance. The goal is to minimize what? It's to get to the swimmer as soon as possible, meaning your goal is to minimize time. Minimize time. So this is going to be a function where the input, where the output is time, not the input is time. So somehow we're going to have to write a formula for time, t. So how are we going to write a formula for time? What you might remember is that distance, we have a formula for distance, is what? Distance is rate times time, meaning that I can solve for time here and get distance over rate. So the total time is going to be the running time plus the swimming time. The running time is whatever the running distance is over the running rate, 13 feet per second, and the swimming time is the distance in the water over the swimming rate, which is 5 feet per second. So that's what we're trying to optimize here. So we could label these variables. We could call this x, and then this distance y. And so our formula, as usual, would have too many variables. Our function of two variables, this is single variable calculus. We can't do it that way. So we'd have to relate one x to y somehow using something else. So can you look at this picture and see how x is going to end up relating to y? And the answer is the Pythagorean theorem. Because if we draw a line straight down from there, we get a right triangle here. And if this distance is x, what would this distance be? The whole distance here is 200. So this short, this distance here would be 200 minus x. And then we could solve for y, it would be what? It would be the square root of 120 squared plus this distance squared. And if we call that 200 minus x, that's okay, but that's going to be sort of a mess when you take the derivative, right? Because you're going to have one function inside of another function inside of another function. It'll work out okay. And most of the time that somebody does this problem on the first try, that's how they would do it. And afterwards you realize, oh, wouldn't it have been much easier if I had called this distance x, and then what would this distance have been? 200 minus x. So that's how we're going to do this. It'll work the other way. It'll just be slightly messier algebra. Meaning now I need to change this x, and I want to call that 200 minus x. We're going to run 200 minus x feet and then dive in and start swimming. So we can rewrite this entirely in terms of x by using the Pythagorean theorem, right? The Pythagorean theorem says that y squared equals x squared plus 120 squared. So we can solve for y, and we get the square root of x squared plus 120 squared. So that's what we can put in here for y. By the way, for this optimization problem. We have two different applets for you. One is exactly this situation with these particular running and swimming rates. And another one, we let you play around with all sorts of different things. You can change how fast you run, change how fast you swim, change the positions. And so really, I encourage you to just play around with both of those applets and explore and enjoy them. Now we've got our function entirely as a formula of one variable, so we can take the derivative. Do we need the quotient rule for these? We could, but it's unnecessary because these are constants on the bottom. You can think about this just as we did in the earlier problem with the aquarium as 1/13th times 200 minus x, in which case the derivative will be 1/13th times the derivative of 200 minus x. Derivative of 200 is 0. Derivative of minus x is minus 1. We can think about this as being a 1/5 out front. And now we've got a square root. So how do we take the derivative of a square root? Square root means to the 1/2 power. So this is something to the 1/2. So the derivative, what rule are we using here? We got one function inside of another, chain rule. So remember, if we had chosen x the other way around, this, instead of being x squared, this would be 200 minus x quantity squared. So if you can just think that that would be a little bit messier here. Something to the 1/2, 1/2, the same thing to the negative 1/2. Then the chain rule says you're not done. You have to take the derivative of the inside, so times 2x. This 2 cancels with that 1/2. Let's clean this up a little bit. Negative 1/13. Now, are you starting to wonder how a lifeguard has all the time to do this? Calculations up. In fact, being a lifeguard is not a very exciting job. I was a lifeguard for 3 summers when I was in high school and college. And you have a lot of time sitting up there doing really nothing except watching people who aren't in any danger at all. So you have lots of time in advance to work out all of these calculations so that you now know, oh, if the swimmer is there, this is where I dive in. If the swimmer is over there, this is where I dive in. So this is how you would do it. So here we go. Here's our function, our derivative. We've got x's in the denominator, so we should be worried about this derivative being undefined. Is there any value of x that we can plug in to make this a 0 in the denominator? No, there isn't, because x squared can't be negative, and so there's no way that I can add this to a positive number and get a 0 in the denominator. So all we have to do is set this equal to 0. There's not really any factoring we can do here, so let's move the 1/13th to the other side. And I've still got this on this side. So often solving an equation means getting rid of what you don't like. So what don't you like about this? There are 2 things I don't like. I don't like fractions, and I don't like square roots. So I want to get rid of that. So to get rid of the fractions, I can get 13x. You can cross multiply is what sometimes people call this. Equals 5 times the square root of x squared plus 120 squared. And now we don't like square roots, so we square both sides. So the square root of 13x is 169x squared. And on the other side, we have to square the 5. We get 25. And when we square the square root, it just goes away. That's good. Well, we don't want to have x's on both sides. So this is a 25x squared. If I bring it to this side, we get 144x squared. And what's left on this side is 25 times 120 squared. Now we just want to divide by 144. X squared equals 25, 120 squared over 144. And at this point, I hope you appreciate how well set up this problem is, because what is every quantity on this side? They're all perfect squares. Do you know how many different numbers I had to plug in before finally that worked out at the end? No, that's not how we do these. When you're making up an optimization problem like this, you actually make it up as a family of curves problem, meaning that I wrote this up with an unknown swimming speed A and a running speed B and an unknown distance, and then worked it all out as a family of curves at the end, and then tried to figure out reasonable values that would make it, you know, values that a human really could swim at this rate and run at this rate, and then it worked out to a nice number like this. And here we go. So we take the square root. Square root of 25 is 5. Square root of 120 squared is 120. Square root of 144 is 12. And that's 50. Now, of course, we want to make sure that this is actually the what? We want to make sure this is the min, because we don't want to be taking the longest possible time to to get to this poor struggling swimmer here. So we need to pick a number over here. I think we can plug in 0. Where is our derivative? If I plug in 0 for this x, this whole fraction becomes 0, so I just get a negative 1/13. So t prime is negative out there, which is good for us because that means t is decreasing. And if you pick a number bigger than 50, you'll see that you get a positive. So in fact, this is the min, just like we wanted. So what does this tell us? What is the path that we're supposed to do? X is this distance in the picture. So we are supposed to run 200 minus x. So our path is to run 150 feet and then start swimming. And if we can actually figure out how far we're going to swim, x is 50 in our swimming distance. I mean, our x is 50 here. So if you take 50 squared plus 120 squared, you get 130 squared. This is one of these nice Pythagorean triplets, like 3, 4, 5. This is a 5, 12, 13 triangle. So if I plug in 50 here, I get 50 squared plus 120 squared, which is 130 squared. So run 150 feet and then swim 50 feet. And that will save this person's life. At least that's the best way to get there. Now, here are a few comments on this. What number, once we took the derivative, made no difference in the problem? The 200. If I had put 2,000 here, the answer would still have been x equals 50, right? Because as soon as I took the derivative here, this 200 was gone. So what this picture, what that's telling you is that it's really all about this triangle part of the picture. It's not about the running part of the picture. As long as this distance here is more than 50, x will always be 50. If this distance is less than 50, then you should just swim straight to the person. But whether this is 200 or 2,000 or 1,000, it doesn't matter. X always works out to be 50. And another thing that I'd like to say is that I was at a conference called MathFest in Madison, Wisconsin one summer, and there was a person there presenting his paper called "Do Dogs Know Calculus?" And what he had done is he had taken his dog, and we have a link to the article that he wrote about this. He'd taken his dog to Lake Michigan, and he had replicated this situation. He stood here, he threw a ball out here, and he kept track of where the dog would enter the water. And he did this repeated number of times, and he measured how fast the dog could run and how fast the dog could swim. And he actually had the dog at the conference. The dog's name was Elvis. Elvis was running up and down the aisles in the big lecture hall, delighting all of the fans. And what he actually discovered is that the dog really did seem to know calculus. The dog really did optimize the path to get to the ball that the math professor was throwing out there. So I think that if the dog can know calculus, then certainly we can know calculus too.